some point a grenade or a shell exploded, look.
So what is that,
shrapnel?
Metal?
Shrapnel, yeah.
Okay. Wow, okay.
This is shrapnel from a grenade or a shell.
Really?
Yeah. All rusty. Well.
Are you taking pictures or video?
This is video. So what do we think of picking up real ordnance from 1942?
It's quite something, isn't it?
Yeah, it is.
Then that's amazing. And just, I mean, if that bits of that hit you, though,
it would do a fair bit of damage.
Yeah.
Yep.
It really would.
It's awful. Really,
yeah. Quite something. It's really something to actually be here, isn't it?
I know, we've only just started.
Yeah.
You wait till we get
This
is a battle. This is Telaissa battlefield, Jesus Hill. And we are walking on a battlefield.
Gosh. Quite something.
So what's the hill called again, please?
Telaissa. Now, if you look at your map and turn your map that way, with the coast,
Right there.
Oh, right, wasn't that right?
This one?
Oh, yeah, I see, yeah. Yeah. And we're right here on point 24.
Okay, we're here.
So,
okay.
Now, by June 1942, it was the South Africans that held the Alamein Box. And the defensive positions started on the coast over there, and it came round in a huge semicircle all the way for another 15 kilometres the other side of El Alamein, and it was all held by the South Africans. May 42, Rommel captures Tobruk, 300 miles in that direction. He advances into Egypt and he reaches a town called Sidi El Rahman, which is 17 kilometres in that direction. Now he reaches Sidi El Rahman last day of June, and Rommel, doing what he always does, as soon as he arrives at the town, he gets whatever troops are available and he sends them straight into the attack. And the African Corps came down the road, they overrun the two hills, which is known as Hill 33, that's where the two monuments are, and they overran all this land, kicking the South Africans out, and they advanced past Hill 26, where the German cemetery is, and they got as far as the Katara track before they were stopped. That was on the 1st of July. Another German column came through the desert about 15 miles south of us, and they reached a ridge called Ruwaizeit, and they were stopped there. But now the British start panicking, because Rommel is so close to Cairo, Alexandria and Cairo, that all the intelligence officers, they start burning all the papers, start packing up all their offices, because they're convinced that Rommel's going to reach Cairo the next day or so. However, on the 10th of July, the Australians have got different ideas. And on the 10th, the Australians counterattack. And they recapture Hill 26, and they come all the way along here. They capture the two monuments, Hill 33. They go over the other side, and they run straight into Rommel's intelligence unit and capture it. So from that point on, 10th of July, Rommel is blind to everything that happens in North Africa. Now, the Australians dig in around this hill and this railway cutting. Now, from lessons learnt at Tobruk, they decide to have infantry on the other side of the railway line and the artillery behind them, because they know at some point Rommel's going to attack them, because he wants the hills. Because on the top of the hills you can see literally for miles. But on the 14th of July, Rommel counterattacks with two panzer divisions, and they're coming straight towards us now. Now, what the Australians do, the infantry just lie low and let the tanks go by. And once the tanks have gone past the infantry, the artillery then deals with it. Yeah? And so the German tank crews get to the railway line, they're really confident, they press on and just rope back out into the desert. The Australians hold this base. Where we are now, you can see the shape of the hill. Sorry, shoot that one. But Tel El Elisa is this hill here. Now, it doesn't look much like a hill, but out in the desert it is.
But that stuff, that ridge there has been dug up recently, hasn't it?
This bit has.
Yeah.
But the railway cutting is still there. We're standing on now.
Well, this is Tel El Elisa Ridge, Jesus Hill. The Australians held this, and this is a significant part of the first battle of El Alamein. And then, as they held it, it was the strong point for the main battle of El Alamein. It's really quite fascinating to be here. Just flat, really. The hills are only 23 metres, 20 to 30 metres high, and that's the only vantage point anybody had. And they were fighting for that little advantage, for the visibility across the flat, open western desert. And it is still quite flat.
Two searchlights. One either end of the line, and they lit up the sky like that, and they lit up the sky like
where
that.
The beam was their objective.
And created the Cross of St Andrew. And every Highlander,
down these 4,000 yards,
was heading for that one cross. Now they didn't make it because it wasn't good enough or anything like that.
It was just too far to go.
And you've got experienced German veterans of the Afrika Korps on the other end.
Thank you, Mohammed.
And the capture of the hills and so forth. Well, this is where they were stopped. And it translates lack in fortune, not valour.
What does it say, sorry?
It translates as lack in fortune, not valour.
It's not they weren't brave, they just weren't lucky.
What, the Germans?
The German Italians. It's an Italian war.
This is where they were stopped on the 1st of July.
El Alamein is just here.
So with a little bit more luck, they could have overrun El Alamein.
On the 1st of July, this is after the first battle.
Yeah. How far is this from where we just were?
4 kilometres. Right, now you see this track here? Yeah. Goes down there. That has been redone in the last few months. But that's your famous Katara track.
It's down to the Katara Depression.
And this is where, just here,
is where 50 RTR force went into battle.
Right, so they were largely up over there.
Yeah.
Just 600 yards. So about where that building is.
They were actually lagered on Hill 26. And then they were brought down. Now, to give you an example of how things worked in them days, on the 22nd of July, 50 RTR, an English Valentine Tank Regiment,
Territorial Army,
yeah, were brought together with the 2nd 28th Australian Infantry and JJ Battery Royal Artillery. And on the 22nd of July, they were told to advance to Mitteraya, capture the Mitteraya Ridge, 9 kilometres away.
That's all we can see on the skyline, is it?
Yeah, right on the skyline. Right, it's late afternoon. Tanks were all formed up, ready to go. Australians were on back of the tanks. The batteries, the gun batteries along here are ready to fire. Call comes through. The guns want you firing in that direction. So the tanks set off. The Australian officers get the men off the tanks, but they continue to advance. But what is happening? The tanks are outstripping the infantry. The tanks, after losing 33 out of 52 tanks, get on top of the ridge. The Australian infantry, who are supposed to be with them, think to themselves, the tanks are in the wrong place. So they dig in a mile short of the real objective. A mile. Brigadier Watkins, he gets in his jeep, he comes racing down this track, he gets up to the Australians, you're too short, get on, no, we're in the right place. So the tanks, after shooting up the Germans on the ridge for a little while, they've got to turn back because they've got no support. So they come back through the minefields, back to a ridge which is about a mile out, a place called Tel El Makat. Right, total disaster, but typical of the day. Right. 1 week later, exactly 1 week later, the same two regiments are told to attack the ridge again. Now the tanks know what they've got to do. They've got to get on the ridge and they've got to get the infantry up there with them so the infantry can dig in and hold the ridge. Well, Australians being Australians, right, they get to the ridge and then start doing their own thing. Right.
Which is?
Well, they decide to go west along the ridge and attack German positions down there, and they're told not to. Nevertheless, get to the ridge.
So if they'd have stayed where they were,
yes,
supposed to.
Which again, the tanks are left on their own,
yeah,
unsupported. So they lose more tanks. And so they've got to make the way, and they came all the way back down here.
Yes.
So in two mistimed, but what's the word I'm looking
Opportunity.
For?
Opportunity.
No.
Disorganised?
Disorganised. Attacks. My grandfather's regiment in the tanks. They lost 33 the first time and 18 the second time. They only had 52 to start with. And the Australians lost the 4,000 men.
This is day two.
This is 22nd and 27th of July.
22nd and 27th?
Yeah. The Germans, well, that when the initial German advance, they got Mitteraya and other places out in the desert. The British had to spend the next few months attacking them in various places, trying to push them away, get them away. And so you have 2nd Alamein is made up of a series of battles, minor battles, if you like.
What level of responsibility would have made those decisions to stop?
What it is, the general will say, right, I want an attack put in up there.
So that gets passed down to the brigadiers, who then gets down, passed down to the battalion commanders. And it's the guys at the front that actually make this, the final decision. But then you get the individual officers, who are perhaps not so confident or not so good at the job.
So experienced, anyway.
That's right. Yeah. But the Australians should have known better, because these were veterans of Tobruk. You know, they spent 10 months fighting the Germans off. You know.
And I blame the Australians.
I said to you the other day that Australian groups today are just like the troops. You know, they didn't like following orders from commies. Mm. You know, and they were good fighters and everything else, but they liked to do, they preferred to do their own thing. Which wasn't always the right thing to do.
Didn't Rommel say that? They were extremely good, but very badly disciplined. He wouldn't want them under his command.
Rommel considered the Highland Division to be the best. Best disciplined. The New Zealanders the toughest, and that was probably because of the Maori content.
Yeah.
And most brutal.
Yeah. And the Australians is probably the toughest, yeah.
But indisciplined.
Yeah. Yeah. He also said, you know, I wish I had him in my army.
I think it's the only a division, didn't he say? There was some limit you put on it.
Yeah.
Together after this kind of mistake, it was afterwards.
He got him, he took him all out into the desert. This is when Winston Churchill came out. He says, look, the army's not ready. Because Monty had read all the reports, you know, seen all the cock-ups and everything else. Mm. And he says, no, I want my men ready. Mm. The Germans have been training a German tank regiment. They would have the tanks and they would build a division around that. They would have their own Panzer Grenadiers, their own Panzer Pioneers, they would have their own infantry, their own rifle regiments. And leading up to World War II, these guys had spent years training with each other.
So they were all integrated.
That's right, yeah.
We didn't do that until post-World War II. We were still not doing that as an integral team. Battle groups only came in the, 60s?
Yeah.
As an all-arms concept.
Yeah. If you read your history books, you'll often see groups, you know, Camp Group Kiel. They'd created these during the war. They didn't come out here as a battle group, they came out here as a division. And what they do, they get a commander named Keel, and he'd say, right, I want a reconnaissance unit, a tank platoon, and some infantry. And it would be given the name of the commander, Camp Group Keel.
They used to kind of tailor-make them, didn't they?
That's right. Required, yeah. And when they did the job they'd been asked to do, it was split up again and everybody went back to the...
Oh, right. Yeah.
Depending on the job, depending on what...
Yeah.
Elements of the division took with you.
Yeah. Yeah. Okay.
Another train.
Honestly, 30 years is the first time I've seen three. I mentioned the name Camp Group Kiel, that was actually in fact Rommel's bodyguard. But because they was his bodyguard, they weren't immune from doing their bit. You know, they would be sent out to do.
So this represents the closest that the Germans got to...
On the 1st of July.
Here, on the post road. On the post road.
Right.
Yeah. And did they get any closer at any other time?
Not on the post road.
Right.
Well, how close do you want to get? It's only here.
to Alex.
Oh, Alexandria, that's 100 kilometres. Yeah,
yeah. This is their furthest point of...
But you can see how far the Australians counterattacked on the 10th. You know, they came from here, took the German cemetery, and the Italian cemetery, look where we were.
You can see how high they are now, can't you?
This is LLM Main rail stop, the famous one.
Perhaps one of the most famous mud brick shitholes ever captured on camera.
I came here in 2006, the sign was on the floor.
Okay.
I was so tempted to take it.
So tempted, well, somebody else beat you to it, unfortunately.
Oh.
This is inside the famous station of Battle of El Alamein. Battle of El Alamein.
I don't think it's a dog.
Sorry?
You
said
you just
said
trolling
a dog to you.
I mean, donkey.
I think it's human.
Oh, no, don't.
Oh, God.
Yeah.
Look. What else would they be?
I don't know.
Maybe not. Who knows?
Yeah, this is quite disgusting. And what a shame. It's in quite a poor state. Be careful where you step in there. Good grief. It's just horrible.
This was built.
To tie your donkey to.
And then it's 54, which would be 54 pounds per foot, is the weight of the rail.
Cracky, how do you know that?
That's the standard code for rail.
Well, that was a pretty face, didn't it?
So I thought this might have been an old piece of rail, but it's not.
Yeah.
Rommel attacked down the road. I also told you he attacked in Lannes. Well, he got as far as here. And this is Ruwaizeit. This is the Ruwaizeit Valley. Huh?
Where is that? What? This ridge here?
No, we're on Ruwaizeit.
We're on it ourselves.
The ridge. Get your map.
Yeah.
You want first Ruwaizeit.
Yeah.
Yeah. And to be in exactly the right position. Your binder needs to be like that. Okay?
Okay.
Yeah. Now
we are.
And we are, if you find point 63 on the map.
Sorry.
Which is there.
There, yeah.
Yeah? You see it? That's that lump there, look.
Oh yes.
Yeah?
Yeah.
And we're what, 500 yards here. Okay, that's where we are now.
Now, that's like right there.
Yeah. And what you look, the Ruwaizeit Valley there, look, is all this in front of you. Yeah? I mean, this new road's lifted the flat valley floor a little bit, but here's all the valley. And it comes across here and across there. Yeah? Now, believe it or not, this is the highest ridge in the area. Yeah, this is the highest ridge in the area. Now, as I said, Rommel, he got to here and was stopped during the initial 1st of July attack. Now, down in the south is a place called Koponga, the New Zealand division were based. And then on the 14th of July, they were ordered to attack Rommel and kick, try and throw him back. And if you look at the map, you can see the direction of the New Zealand attack.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah? The New Zealand's came. And they were coming more or less straight towards us. Yeah? Now, one of the guys during the attack, Keith Elliott, he was under fire from this hill, .63, and the Germans had surrounded it with machine guns, and they were covering the whole valley. Well, Keith Elliott, he decides to take a few men across the valley and go and deal with the machine guns. He lost most of the men going, but he got there, put all the machine guns out of action, and survived. And he got the Victoria Cross. Yeah. Now, on this side, much the same time, about, see the dark shadow there mm-hmm. on the ridge? Yeah?
Mm-hmm.
So this is still Ruiz 8 Ridge. Charles Upham does much the very same thing, taking out machine guns. Because believe you me, if you've got this ridge lined with machine guns, you can stop anything that's coming this way. So Charles Upham does much the same thing, and his citation's in your booklet. And he gets the Victoria Cross. But what's different with him, he gets it for the second time.
He won
the Victoria Cross in Crete.
Wow.
And he would win it again here. Gosh. And he's the only fighting man in history to get two Victoria Crosses.
Got it.
And he was an Englishman, was it?
New Zealander.
New Zealander?
New Zealander.
Yeah. What was his name again?
Charles Upham.
Upham?
Yeah. His full citation is in the U-book. Anyway, the New Zealanders, they're coming in strong, they're putting up a good fight, but the Germans here are just too strong. They've got far better equipment, the defences are laid out a lot better. So eventually the New Zealanders have to push back to where they started at Kaponga Box. Well, a week later, on the 22nd of July, remember I told you on the 22nd of July my grandfather's regiment attacked down the Katara track?
Yeah.
Complete cock-up. Well, the other two tank regiments of the brigade were down there, 3 miles down the valley. Now, if you turn your map over to 2nd Ruiz 8th, yeah, and keep it in, how we've got it this time, keep it in that direction, yeah? So you're still matching the same, like that, yeah? Now, the 1446 RTR, they're ordered to attack down this valley. But in the meantime, the Germans, they've lined both ridges with anti-tank guns. And they've got anti-tank guns along here, this line here. And then they've got tanks behind them. They've done all this during the time the New Zealanders have pulled back. So, General Gott, who commanded the operation, he got Brigadier Meeser to send 104 tanks of the remainder of his brigade down this valley. And it was just like the charge of the Light Brigade. Identical. They came down the valley, they ran onto minefields. Those that survived the minefields then began to receive fire from the anti-tank guns. And they're losing tanks all the time. Now, one squadron from 46 RTR can see all the damage that's going on. And the commander of the squadron, he decides to take his tanks up onto the ridge over here. Well, up on there is a young 19-year-old German called Gunter Helm. And he's a gun layer. And he picks off every single one of these tanks. He later gets the Knight's Cross for this off Rommel, and his actual footage of him getting the medal. Yeah, and he died.
actual footage of him getting the medal. And he only died 2 weeks ago.
Two weeks ago.
What did he use to take the tanks down?
Just his good aiming. He was the gun layer. It was him that used to look down the telescope. And the rest of the crew would shoot the gun light.
And was this with the 88mm or a PAK-40?
Both.
Alright.
Now, along here, the German tanks and the 88s are waiting for them. They started off 3 miles down there with 102 tanks. By the time Gunter Helms finished with them, and the rest of the German anti-tank gunners, they're down to about 20. Mm. They get to here, and then the 88s kick in. And then the German panzers, who don't have to move, because the English tanks are coming towards them. And at the end of the day, the 23rd Armoured Brigade had eight tanks left from here.
Was decimated.
They had eight tanks left out of this battle. My grandfather's regiment, they lost 33. So if you add that up, 33
and
88. So many on the first day of battle.
121.
General Gott, he blamed the brigadier, who was only following orders. So he was sent back to Cairo to train recruits. General Gott.
They dropped a rank, didn't they? They dropped him to colonel as well.
General Gott was given command of the 8th Army. Now you were that out. You were that out. It was given. It's mad. Totally mad. Yeah.
This was the first battle.
This is first Alamein,
Yeah.
And the 14th, 15th of June, when the New Zealanders attacked. Mm. And 22nd of July, when 23rd Army Brigade attacked. And that all happened here, all within sight of what everything I've told you, all happened here.
So why didn't they go on? Why didn't he go on then?
Rommel. Who?
Rommel. Like,
he was never strong enough. Never at any time was Rommel...
crucified 85 tanks or something.
Rommel, at no point in the Desert War did he have more petrol than the British, more tanks, more men.
He's just knocked out over 80 tanks.
Yeah, but the rest of the 8th Army's up there.
How many is that?
100,000, 150,000.
But tanks, how many tanks?
Tanks, at Alamein, he started with 900.
Tanks.
And that's after they'd been reinforced and so forth, yeah.
The only problem for Rommel was he had those long lines of supply.
That's right.
If
you wanted a gallon of petrol, you'd have to go to Alexandria.
Yeah.
Rommel had to go 800 miles.
Yeah.
And 9 times out of 10, a truck carrying fuel would eat up its own fuel just to get here.
Yeah.
Brigade uses 20,000 gallons of fuel a day. The brigade.
Okay, you've got German tankers coming from Italy, but they're getting sunk on the way by British submarines.
And Tobruk wasn't fully functional, was it? Because there were still quite a few wrecks in the.
That's right. Yeah. Yeah.
So Tripoli was still, I think, his main supply, wasn't it?
See, and the other thing you've got. All the base, Rommel's bases at this time would be Merzim Matruh, Bardia, Tobruk, Benghazi. They were all being attacked by the Long Range Desert Group and the SAS. So if you cut or disrupt Rommel's supply lines, that made it even harder for him. You know, later you learn about the Battle of Alam Helfer. We call it that. The Germans call it the 6-day race. Because Rommel had 6 days worth of petrol. Now he could use them up. 6 days of fighting, 2 days to advance, 2 days to fight, 2 days to retreat. Or use all 6 days and go straight for Cairo. Whichever way you worked it out, he only got 6 days worth of petrol. Yeah, because his supply lines was just so long. Yeah. Now if you look just there, that's one of the original battlefield cemeteries just there, look.
Anyone still in it, or they've moved them all?
Pardon?
Anyone still in it, or they've moved them all?
Yeah, they're all in the main cemetery.
Well, that's
now.
The site of the old one, is it, originally?
Yeah, that was the one that was built at the time, and there's...
So there's another cemetery, one down there's here. No one there, is that what you're saying?
That's right, that's one of the...
Oh.
Once the party had moved on,
yeah.
And they picked up all the dead in that's where they all put them.
So German, or...?
Are they?
British. But no, I mean, I say British, but there was all sides. You know, they didn't leave a body laying in the sand.
Yeah.
And if it happened to be German, they'd put him in there with the mark that he was German, like, you know. Yeah. But Rommel repeated Wellington's words, because after Waterloo, Wellington said they came in on the same in the same old way. We stopped them in the same old way, and Rommel repeated that because he did exactly what Wellington had done years before. The other thing with the British, like the Valentines, if you've got the Valentine tank. Now the gunner's sitting there, right? He's got two little wheels to turn the turret round and round and round. He's got his eye in the eyepiece like that. And he's got the actual gun to lift it up and down in a shoulder crutch, right? Now, what he's got to do to shoot a German tank is like this, with his eye in there like that. Mm-hmm. And he's bouncing all over the desert, right?
Mm.
So consequently, they always missed.
Mm.
German tanks didn't do that.
Mm.
When they saw a target, the commander would say, driver stop, tank stops, the gunner then has got He's got no movement, he's got nothing to distract him. Takes aim, destroys the British tank.
So why didn't we do that?
Because they were not so wise.
What about the guy behind him?
What guy behind him?
The tank behind him. Can't just stop bloody tank and no tank behind him.
Tanks don't go into battle in line. They go in a vast armada.
So there's no tank behind him?
No. They go in a vast armada spread out.
Wellington also said it was a close-run thing.
Yes, because the Prussians were late. Germans again. Yeah. The Prussians were late coming to Waterloo, weren't they?
Yeah, but he got there in the end.
Yes.
The other thing
he got there in the end.
So did the British eventually.
The only about bouncing about at the time, like, you're banging your head. It's nothing much better than a tank.
It's on the outside of a tank with a swagger stick.
Yeah.
Tally-ho, chaps. And they go into a tank battle sitting on the outside of a tank.
Yeah.
Now they didn't do it for long. they were shot off, like, you know.
Yeah.
But
yeah.
And these were like fighting units, a bit like the German battle groups, yeah, in the Gulf. But the battle at Sidi Rezegh in Libya, the British tanks were up against the German tanks. But the Brits weren't doing so well because they were badly positioned and so forth. And old Jack Campbell just gets out his jeep with his swagger cane. He goes up to one tank. Knock, 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 knock. Commander sticks his head out. You know, I'll talk to you on that. You know. I want you firing over there. So you go off to the next tank. Knock, knock, knock. I want you firing over there. And he got the Victoria Cross for that. He survived the battle. Walking from tank to tank in a major battle.
Yeah.
The biggest, the biggest tank battle in North Africa. And he's walking from tank to tank.
Right. Telling him what to do.
Telling him what to do. 3 months later, he gets killed in a traffic accident.
So where was this battle?
In Libya, that was. Sidi Rezegh.
What was his name?
Jock Campbell. Yeah, Brigadier Jock Campbell. Yeah.
So the Jock column was named after him?
That's right, yeah.
Right.
Yeah. Well, what he did, he got two or three 25-pounders, half a dozen lorry fulls of troops and a couple of few jeeps for reconnaissance.
Yeah.
And they were called Jock columns after him. And it was like the first British attempt to
integrate
a group. Yeah.
Camp
group
thing.
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah. But, yeah, I mentioned the young German going to hell. You can't talk about Rommel and the African Corps without talking about going to hell. And it's very debatable who is the more famous.
I've never heard of
23rd Armoured Brigade, they were also known as Monty's Foxhounds. And when they used to have the reunions after the war, Gunter Hell was
still alive.
Another quite emotional time was when the 60th anniversary, the Desert Rats, Mantle Rommel was guest of honour. They brought David Montgomery on the stage. Got special guests of honour with us now. And they announced Manfred Rommel and he couldn't walk in onto the stage.
Oh boy.
The audience went mental. And man from Rommel couldn't believe the reception he was getting. Yeah. Couldn't believe it. It was a poor guy, he was in tears. Because 8th Army veterans never used to say, I fought with Monty. He used to, I fought Rommel. Yeah. Big difference, yeah. And they had more respect for Rommel than they ever did for Montgomery. You know, because Rommel was a frontline general. And if he was visiting you, your unit, he was the last person you wanted to see because you know within a day or so you're going into battle. Yeah? And, you know, and German veterans have told me this. You know, he was highly respected, but he was the last person they wanted to see. And Rommel, again, because of actions later in the war, he'd become known as the last knight of Europe. Mm. Yeah. Right, let's take a few photos, and then we'll bring on then, down to the bridge, Yeah, well that's known as the Bab el Qatara, or Gateway to the Qatara. Yeah. Now, I know that for the main battle on the 23rd of October, the main British army attacked from the north. But they had three divisions down here, the British did, and they launched a diversionary attack on the 21st Panzer Division, which was, they were sitting over here. Now the 7th Armoured was split up with the 50th and the 44th Divisions, and the Foreign Legion as well. And the Foreign Legion would attack from a big hill called Hemmima over the horizon. We'll see it in a bit. And they would come along this way. Next to them would be the newly arrived 44th Division. And your uncle's unit would come straight down here towards us. And there were two big minefields called January and February. But they were planted by the British, you know. Germans got on the scene and they just stuck a few more in. You know, because they knew, the British knew where they'd put their own mines, you know. And just as a diversion, all three divisions attacked the German 21st. But for John here, his uncle, he came straight towards us here. Yeah.
What unit was that, John?
I'm not sure.
It was the, it was attached to the East Kent.
Yeah. East Kent?
East Yorkshire.
East Yorkshire.
East Yorkshire. Which were in the Tyne Tees Division.
Tyne Tees Division.
And their objective was just to tie up the 21st Panzer Division. That didn't quite happen, and a short time later, the 21st Division moved straight up to the coast to help defend against the British attacks in the north. But by having done that, what they'd done was left the desert open for the French in the 44th and 50th just to advance through. But that didn't happen until all three divisions had lost a lot of men. And it was just over the ridge in my map that Etienne Szabo, you know, the Alexis husband was killed.
See, with that unit then, people's coming out.
Now, if you're in New Zealand, we're away on the 14th and 15th of July.
That's quite a few down.
In the south here. It's hot. Your uncle Ward.
They're still pretty much.
But the Germans were far better than that, and they never left a damaged tank on the battlefield. Nine times out of ten, the British would go in and blow it up. Let's see if I can put a name to it. Half the names I can't pronounce anyway, but. Yeah. See, this one's far more detailed.
So that's map 68, is it?
Bab el Qatara.
Map 68, is that for Steve?
Pardon?
Map number 68.
68, yeah. Bab el Qatara, If it's possible to read that, that's where we are. We've been there, we've drove through El Alamein. We haven't been to Mitteray yet. Deer O'Sheen, where the woman spread her ashes. We'll wait out where we stopped. And then we're just before here now. And then we're going down to there. There's trenches and all sorts down there and bunkers. Yeah. This was the end of the El Alamein line as built by the British. And it was held various times by British and New Zealanders. New Zealanders called it the Kaponga Box. However, when Rommel attacked Alam Helper, he repeated his plans from Gazala, and that was to go south of the British line. And he came through here, and this place was overrun. And when you get to the top of the ridge, you'll see a Hemaimat. The Germans had advanced right up to Hemaimat, captured Hemaimat, which is a big hill up in the distance. Well, since then, that day, this was held by the Italians, and they transformed it into a hospital. And ever since, it's been known as the Italian Hospital. But it was, in fact, the last of the original El Alamein lines. The other one that's left used to be in the grounds of the museum. Right. So from early September, the Battle of Alam Helper, this was entirely in Italian hands. There was a memorial put up in 2013, but one of the locals have decided to smash it.
One of which blokes smashed it?
One of the locals.
And what are these little cement works?
Well, these are the air vents.
Ah.
These are a series of trenches and tunnels and bunkers.
So it goes underground then?
Yeah. Yeah. And it defended. The idea is they built it here because this is the only exit in this area after the Qatari Depression. Because they thought Rommel at one stage might come through there, or the Italians from Libya. And that's why this was built here. But it was open.
Well, you can see down there. Sorry.
You go on.
Did they have much in the way of sandbags, Steve?
Yeah, you'll find the remains of sandbags dotted around here.
Okay.
Yeah. It, more so into Brook, because it's drier. Yeah.
Yeah, the sandbag here. There's plenty of sandbags.
This is they were Hessian, were they?
75-year-old sandbag. This is the trench system. This is the gateway to the Qatari Depression.
If you look across the ridge, you can find various machine gun posts that cover this position.
There's a sandbag residue trench system. Sandbags. Liz. Some of these trenches are still quite open.
This one's quite a sandbag.
You can see machine gun post here.
Depression.
It's beyond there.
Down through
2,000 miles long.
Oh, okay.
This is a typical sangha. The entrance is here. So the guys would set the machine facing in this direction. And they would be covering the bunkers and the entrance to the depression, or the exit from the depression.
Goes through those
gaps
in the bridges.
It's 3,000 miles in that direction.
So too difficult to build, too difficult to dig, so they use rocks for a sangha. But fear of splinters from the stones as well as shrapnel.
All these piles of rocks. See, rocks in the desert don't appear like that on their own. They're all man-made. So when you scan your eyes across the desert, you can see which is natural and which is man-made. And they appear, they would probably have had some lights or anti-aircraft.
So what's the name of this box?
If you're a New Zealander, it's Kaponga box. And to everybody else, it's the Bab al-Khatara.
Bab al-Khatara.
Yeah.
Which means the gateway to the Qatar Depression. Just so flat. I found some ration tins, circa 1942, for the collection. More sanghas over there.
So those are original then, those concrete slabs?
No, post-war.
Oh, right, oh, okay.
And so what the Egyptian army used to do was to lay more of these slabs, and then once a year or twice, yeah, once every 2 years, they'd come and collect them all up.
So the Egyptian army used the war minefields for practice, for mine detection?
Yeah.
That's what you're saying?
Yeah. Yeah. You know, which teaches the soldiers, and also clears the area.
Clears the area, yeah.
When you see all the protests, this, that and the other about the mines at El Alamein, it's nonsense, because most of them are gone now. It's only when you get out to places out there or further along here that you come across them.
German Panzer up there, defending.
Up here?
Yeah.
When? On the 22nd of July?
When the 50th, when the 51st Highland and the New Zealanders and the Australians came through here, what formation was up there?
There was an Italian unit and the 164th. Where's your map? No, we checked in the podium on and he just brought up the Panzers from the south here. Once this ridge had been captured then, Montgomery's idea was to head in a westerly direction then.
Uh-huh.
Go off in that direction and try and break the German line across the Raman track.
So go this way around?
Yeah, so he took the ridge and then he went like that to go this way. Okay. And there should be... That's a more detailed Highland Division map, that one is.
Uh-huh.
But there's Mitiraya here.
Yeah.
And once you've captured Mitiraya,
uh-huh,
it sort of did 90 degrees and went that way towards Tel El Akhir.
Uh-huh.
But we'll see this just a bit later.
Cool.
So we can't see Hill 63 from here, can we? You said we can see the whole battlefield from here in that direction?
Yeah.
So the Italian and the German cemeteries we saw first there?
They're Hill 33 over there.
Those distant blips in the horizon?
Yeah, that's that tall building there.
They are those?
Yeah.
That's Hill 33. Don't forget there are two satellites.
That little orange one.
Hill 26 is a German
where the trees
one.
Are there.
Where the trees are there.
Was it hill? Have I got the hill down?
There's a little box on it, isn't there?
If you go straight to that building there, this building at the other side of the road bridge, is the German one is in the far distance.
Okay, the German one's the first one, and then
there's the Italian, Italian one over there. Yeah. Those two round things in the middle of the satellite.
Yeah, straight to where we are.
I bought the book, have a look at it.
Just in front of the Italian one.
German is there.
The Italian Lisa railway station. And that's where we first stopped this morning.
So we're just looking back, would be a spin?
Yes, so we're looking, yeah.
Railway station there.
But now you're actually in the middle of the main battlefield itself.
So how far back did the Germans go from this ridge? This was their front line, presumably.
Yeah, well, once the ridge had been lost, they started to pull back to the Ramman track, which is a track that runs parallel to this one, but in 20 kilometres over there.
Crikey.
And they formed up defence lines again.
I'm pretty hacked off just fighting over this bunch of rubble.
I'm sure it's better looking rubber in those days.
I think you think you just sit still. I've not got better things to do.
Had a hard life.
What do they say? Acres and acres of shit coloured nothing.
Well, that's about right, isn't it?
So is this the track as well to Fort Capuzzo? Is that how you pronounce it? Fort Capuzzo?
Capuzzo.
Capuzzo.
That's in Libya.
Yeah, but on your map it does say this is where it goes to. On the other page.
Oh, that might be the Merseburg True map.
No, it's one that... Here, that there. Is that my glasses? That looks like Capuzzo.
Final objective, it says.
Oh, okay, that's because I can't read, sorry. Ignore my last three or four sentences.
I will do, yeah.
All right, Mohammed.
Basically in El Alamein Cemetery from these actions that were killed here?
All that you've seen today, yes. Yeah. And then you've got another one. Down this road on the left is a pyramid, which is the Ramman track, and we'll be stopping there as well. So. But once the British had captured the ridge, the army sort of went like that then, in these two attacks. That's actually the wrong way around. Ramman tracks coming from there. There's a railway line coast. Once the ridge had been captured, they went like that in that direction. So we're attacking this way, at this angle, if you like. And once the ridge was captured, they went like that. But you've just driven. We would have driven down here normally if they hadn't built the new road, but we've driven right across the main battlefield, east to west. Yeah. Also, about 15 years ago, this cleared ground here was surrounded by minefields.
You know, 15 years ago.
That's why the area was... There's the entrance, the track running across back to the main road. There's a track.
So how deep would the minefields be?
Roughly... 3 kilometres deep.
So how do you...
This way.
The track?
This way. And close on 40 that way.
Just see this.
You just found that?
Myself,
good lad.
We were Calvary.
Where's that bullet?
What? It's in my bag.
Well, did you find it here?
Yeah.
Then it's probably an Allied bullet.
Nice.
Bloody hell. Can I have that one?
Sure.
Good lad. I've got hundreds of them like that. But this one's hit something, that's why I like this one.
I'm not sure about that one, what it is. I don't think that's a projectile.
It is, that's a bullet, but it's just been laying in water and rusted up.
You can see the rifle in there. Can you see it there?
Germans.
Well, they were running for their lives, weren't they?
Yeah.
No, I don't know. I don't know where that cropped up about Rommel being captured.
There was another guy captured, wasn't there? Von Toma?
Von Toma. He was captured by the 10th Hussars, that's right.
Little green.